I'm a really lucky guy. I get to take care of all the photographs, the manuscripts, the documents.
If you stacked up all our stuff in end, it would be a stack 350 feet high. There's so much cool stuff. The Flaten Wange collection is probably our biggest and our best. It's the combined collections of two photographers who worked here in Clay County, each for about 50 years or more. It's a tremendous collection, 15,500 glass plate negatives taken between 1879 and about 1940 or 45 or so. It's just a tremendous resource. The photographers are very different men. Their personalities are different. Their approaches to photography, their background in photography is all very different, and that shows up in their work. Flaten, the Moorhead photographer, learned photography using the wet plate process in the 1870s, a very exacting, very demanding process. So many of his photos, even photos with people in them, are like still lifes. It took a long exposure and it was very difficult. You had to get it right the first time. So he's a very, very careful workman and placed people just so. Wange's work, he learned with the dry plate process, a much simpler process. His photography, though sometimes it's not well focused or it's overexposed or underexposed, not as technically brilliant as Flaten's, it often has a spontaneity and a humor to it that you really don't find in Flaten's stuff. Well, this is S.P. Wange right here. He was notorious for betting. One day he bet a friend of his $50 that he wouldn't cut his hair for a full year. Wange was a barber. So he went for the full year, he collected his $50, he won the bet, and took this self-portrait of himself. Then he went downstairs into his barbershop and he cut his own hair. These are studio portraits. They have to stand fairly close. He's taking the picture indoors, so it's a fairly long exposure, so he has to have some control over it. But more typical of his work is like this. It's grossly overexposed and underexposed on each side. But it's a great photo. It's a snapshot sort of a quality to it. A bunch of guys skinny dipping in the Buffalo River with their horses after a long day of work, probably. This one over here, for instance, we don't know who this chap is right here. It's a great photo. It's probably a friend of Wang's. He's got these sleeves on, so we suspect he's a clerk of some kind. But Wange caught him snoozing one day and took his image. Flaten here in Moorhead was practically the only photographer in town for about 50 years. And he had a real strong sense of history. He realized, especially toward the end of his career in the 20s, that he wasn't just taking pictures for money or even for pleasure, but he was doing documentary photography. He knew that he was part of the history of the community, and the community had a long history, and he was documenting that.
Well, this is a great photo. This is from the 1897 flood, one of the worst floods we've had in Fargo-Moorhead history. This is looking north on 4th Street in Moorhead from about 7th Avenue south. This is A.W. Bowman and Molly Otto out for a boat ride on 4th Street. This house right here, that's the O.M. Martinson House. That's the Rourke Art Gallery today. And you can see that this is the coulee that runs back through Concordia College's campus and Prairie Home Cemetery, and the water obviously backed up into that in 1897. Then there's this one over here. This is from, of course, the ruins of the 1893 fire. It was a devastating fire that wiped out most of downtown Fargo in June of 1893. Started in a back of a store down on Main Avenue and Broadway, and there was a strong south wind that just swept the fire right through the middle of town. Burned up everything basically from 4th Street over to Robert Street, from what's now Main Avenue north past the city limits. It actually started a prairie fire that extended another 3 miles out of town. Tremendous damage, made lots and lots of people homeless. Curiously, it had a positive effect on Fargo. Many of the buildings that were burned down were substandard, there were wood frame structures, and there was also in 1893, there was a nationwide depression on. There was a sudden influx of cash into the community from insurance settlements. So and actually, in many ways, it gave Fargo kind of a boost. Many of the buildings in downtown Fargo now are remnants of the rebuilding that happened after that fire.
Well, it's great to look back and see what the communities looked like in those times. And you can learn a tremendous amount from just studying photographs. Pictures of construction scenes, for instance, if you look at them with a magnifying glass, and a magnifying glass is a great tool, you can see details in photographs that'll tell you how the construction activities went. Not only what people looked like, but the clothing styles that they wore, the things that they did. It's all revealed in photographs.
This is a great photo. This is one of Wang's work. This fellow was a scorcher back in the 1890s. Bicycles were extremely popular, not among kids, but among young adults because they couldn't afford carriages, hence the song Daisy and whatnot. But this guy's a scorcher. He was a racer, and his bicycle reflects that. It was extremely lightweight, one speed, probably high geared, and it doesn't have any what they call junk on it, like lights or brakes. For instance, there's no brakes on this bicycle whatsoever, but it was extremely light, probably well under 20 pounds. His suit obviously reflects, you know, his desire for speed. Like I say, these guys were called scorchers, and they were notorious for causing problems. They keep their heads down and they just go like heck. I've looked at this photo many, many times with a magnifying glass, and I've yet to figure out how they can get this guy to stand up. He doesn't have any kind of a propping or anything like that. He's balancing himself there for perhaps maybe half a second exposure or so, and I can't figure out how he did it. It's a tremendous collection. The collection came in kind of unusual in two separate sections. S.P. Wang worked in Hawley, and when he moved out of his photo studio around 1940 or so in downtown Hawley, he abandoned, apparently, the negatives in the attic. Many years later, a local attorney purchased the building, discovered the negatives, and brought them in. So we've got about 14,000 negatives that came in that way. Flaten's work was here in Moorhead. When he retired in 1929, he sold the business to a relative that was also sold eventually to the Gross family. The Gross family found them in the studio. They brought in about 800 images that Flaten shot here in Moorhead, and we're really blessed to have those. O.E. Flaten was quoted in a Moorhead newspaper in 1914 as saying at that time, in 1914, he had 129,000 negatives in his collection. Most of them were studio portraits. Can you imagine the imagery that is of just about everybody in town, plus people from Fargo and all over the community? Well, unfortunately, his cousin apparently, when he took over the studio, sold the bulk of the negatives for a little tiny bit of metallic silver that exists in each black and white negative. And just for fractions of a cent apiece, they disappeared. If people find similar sorts of things, don't throw them away. Don't throw them away.
Production funding is provided by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and the citizens of Minnesota, and by the members of Prairie Public.